Sagarika madam.
Yes, sir. Am I audible, sir?
Madam.
Okay. Thank you
audible,
so much, sir.
Audible.
Very good morning to all the learners. And once again, we are here with another class of web technology. Before going to this session, I just want if there are any doubt regarding the previous session, that is the basic HTML tag. In the last class, we have discussed about the basic HTML tags, their usage, as well as we have demonstrated various examples relating to list, tables, and other tags like paragraph, break, the header tags, etc., etc. So all those tags are treated as a basic tag. That means we need those tags for creating our web page, for creating our screen over the browser, right? But one thing all of you must have a doubt, when there will be a browser and when we are writing a simple HTML code, in that case, we are only concentrating about the work area of the browser. That means we are writing a single file and that single file is only executed over that browser. When we want to some additional features, then we have to incorporate that in that single file, because that single file is executed and the output is displayed over the browser. But what happens when we want more than one files to be executed simultaneously or to be executed? Just like in our today's nowadays, where there are lots and lots, thousands and millions of websites are available. In every page, we can view that there will be various different features are there. Some features are at the right part, some features are at the left part, and some are in a specific location, right? So is that all are written in a single HTML document file? If one will arise a question like that, so I will answer that no. In a single document file or in a single HTML file, we cannot write all the features that are currently available in our website. So for that, we have to be used multiple number of HTML files executed simultaneously so that it will be give a brief look. So in today's class, as the topic, whatever we have discussed today, we are going to discuss today, that will be called as your advanced HTML. In the previous class, we have successfully covered the basic HTML, but here we are going to the advanced HTML. So what is that advanced? This is the advanced that we are going to execute multiple web pages, multiple HTML documents simultaneously, as well as we want to know how the document will accept the data. Right, as nowadays everything will be happened online, the online examination, online form fill up, online registration. So how those pages are used or created and what are the different features of that pages that we are going to discuss in today's class. Okay, so let me share my screen first. Is it visible to all?
Yes, yes, madam. Visible.
Okay, thank you, sir. So here the topic advanced HTML that will be defined in your web technology unit 2 of block 1. So we will start. Now, another new term that will be called as a frame. So before going to demonstrate what is a frame, I just want to describe the definition of frame, where we can need the frame. Frame are used to divide the browser window into sections. That means what is the browser window? The window that defined our laptop screen or desktop screen, a complete browser having some menu bars, toolbars, or our address bar and the work area, whatever that will be called as your browser window. So frames is a tag or frame is a control in HTML that will able to divide that browser into various section. And how we can divide the section? We can have discussed what are the features so that how we can able to divide those sections. So in simple case, as a layman, what we understand, what is a frame or what is the use of a frame? Frame will be used to divide the browser screen in a multiple section, as simple as that. Okay. So if we are using multiple section, or if we are using or dividing multiple section, then we need multiple HTML program to be executed in each and every section. That's why we can possible to execute simultaneous HTML code in a single browser. The output will be displayed in a single browser, but each HTML file have a specific section, right? So here, as I have written, what is a frame? Frame are used to divide the browser window into sections. Here, collection of multiple frames is called as a frame set. Now, look at this. Why I am highlighting this? Because itself frame set, some set of frames. Here, if we are taking this term, frame set, set of frames, that means we are defining that each HTML program or each HTML file will be treated as a separate frame, and it need to be executed in a specific section in the browser window, right? So for that, your the tag name is frame set tag, used to create a frame layout structure instead of body tag. Remember, if we are going to use the frame set tag, we cannot use, or we need not to be used the body tag, because body tag is associated with the browser area where we are executing something. But previously we are executing a single file. So inside the body tag, whatever we are written, whatever we are executed, that will be displayed in a single browser window. But here the body tag will be replaced by your frame set tag. So when this has to be remembered, because this might be your exam point of view, this might be important. So in some cases, you are written whether frame set is used or body tag is used for frame creation. So you have to be remembered that when we are using a frame set tag, we no need to use the body tag. We can use, or we can give some line, but if the frame will be not executed successfully, then it will execute the body tag, right? So inside frame set, as I have told, that it is a set of frame. That means you need to specifically describe what are the content of each and every frame. As because it is a set, that means multiple number of frames has to be executed, multiple number of HTML files has to be executed. So what are the content of each and every HTML file that need to be defined inside another sub tag called as your frame tag? It is frame set and it is frame, right? So what is a frame? Define the frame content. What we want to view, what we want to execute, that frame content needs to be right inside the frame tag or the HTML document that is to be uploaded in the frame, right? So whenever we are going to demonstrate any specific frame tag or any specific frame set, first of all, we have to be ready with our multiple HTML file, which we want to execute in our different frame section. Next, according to the attributes, as we have discussed in the previous class, tag is not always important only. Tag always dependent on the various attributes. What are the attributes written inside the tag, that will be more important. So as I have told here, frame set have some specific attributes separately, and inside the frame set, the frame had some specific attributes separately. So before going to demonstrate, first of all, we need to understand why we are using the attribute. What is the need of the attribute, right? So let's suppose take the frame set tag. Okay, so in case of frame set tag, the different attributes are, first is calls. Here it is defined the column name or the column number or the column percentage. Okay, so as it is calls, so what data or what value we have to define? We have to define in how many percentage you are going to divide your browser window. if I am using two different frame, then whether I will want them in a 50-50 format or whether I will want them in a 30-70 format, whatever, in what percentage you are going to divide the browser window, that has to be defined in both columns attribute as well as rows attribute. Okay, you remember this, you have to give the percentage value. So why rows and columns? Because columns will divide it vertically, whereas rows will divide it horizontally. So we will see that in the demonstration part. Remember that the value that is given for columns attribute or rows attribute, that should be in a percentage. And the total percentage must be 100%, because we are considered that the total browser area is supposed to be a 100% area, and we are dividing that 100% area into some specific percentage of specific section, right? Next, border, as it is named, as simple as that, we are going to divide each and every section with a specific border. So in case of border, we have to give the pixel value, the number of pixel, how, what width you want, that will be given in the borders. Let's suppose, for example, 5 or 10 or 50. But remember, the more, the wider the border, the content area of the section will be squeezed. So mostly preferable that the border should be within 10 to 20 pixels only, or 10 to 20 numeric value only. Next, called as your frame border, right? Frame border means before using this border, you have to give the frame border. Remember, here I am specifying it 0 or 1. That means either it will be a true value or either it will be a false value. 0 is for false and 1 is for true. So what is the need of frame border? Whether you want the border or not, or in which specific time you want the border, that will be defined in terms of 0 or 1. If it will, the frame border will be a value 0, that means it is always in a false state, disabled state. Even if the in the coding part you have written the border, but it will be in the disabled state till the frame border will be value 1 or will be in the value of true. Okay, whenever it will be true, then only the border value will be executed, otherwise it will be in a disabled format. Next, called as frame spacing. Frame spacing, it is the most interesting attribute of a frame control or frame set tag. That sometime you must have seen, we have a window size, and there will be, when we will take the mouse pointer to the corner or to the lining part, the border part of the window, there will be a arrow symbol, a two-dimensional arrow symbol that define us, we can minimize or we can maximize the window size. Okay, similarly here, frame spacing will allow us to, whatever percentage we are given in the columns or rows, that can be changed by scrolling the mouse pointer or scrolling the cursor, and that will be always available when your frame spacing attribute is used, right? So these are the five attributes that will associated with the whole frame set. That means each and every section, they are dependent on these five attributes. Next, come to individual section or individual frame. That inside frame set, we have to use the frame for individual section. In the frame tag, the most mandatory attribute is your SRC. In the previous section, we have used these SRC attributes using your image tag, right? IMG space SRC. And SRC will hold what? It will hold the URL name, the path name where the HTML file will be uploaded, from where it will be uploaded to the current frame, right? So name, as an ID, we can give a name to individual frame. Frame border, individual section have a specific border. We can change the margin width and margin height according to that. And scrolling, whatever frame spacing will be defined the space between all the section, right? But in case of scrolling, you can change the spacing by the scrolling attribute. Okay, so mostly the scrolling will help to define the frame spacing value. You can say that value or frame spacing pixel. Okay, so before going to the next iframe, I just want to demonstrate to you how we are dividing the browser section. Okay, so first of all, here is my notepad. Here I am taking a simple example of a simple HTML document. I have used HTML tag, head tag, title. In the title, I have used first frame. Then in the body tag, I am using the BG color yellow. Look, this is, in this program, I am not using the frame. So I have to use the body color, body tag, right? And this is for the background color. Inside this file, I am just going to write a simple message. My top frame. Okay, so first of all, let me save this. dop.xsuppose.dop1.html. Yes, he is already. Yes, look here. The top one HTML file will be successfully executed. Next, I will take another two file with the same structure. Control C. First, I have changed the title and the content of the frame with a different BG color. Okay, so file, save as. Let's suppose I have given it another name called as middle dot html, right? Similarly, I will take the third frame. Why I am taking three different frame? Because I have to demonstrate you what are the different structure area, how you will divide the browser window. So hence I have taken three different. In the third file, the title is third frame, the body color is different, the background color, and the content is my bottom frame. So let me save it as your bottom.html. So here I have executed three different frame. Okay, now I have to be execute these three different HTML file in a single file using the frame tag. So here, this is my HTML frame code. HTML tag as it is, head, title, head, as it is in the normal HTML program. But here, I am not using the body. Yes, I am using the body tag. If these frame tag will not execute, then only the body tag will be executed. Otherwise, if this frame set tag will successfully execute, then the system or the HTML browser will avoid this body tag. Okay, so what we have written here, look, I have told you that the tag name is frame set. That means you have to define the area for each and every frame. Here I am using calls, and I have given three different value in percentage area, right? So is that will be total of 100, 25, 25, 50? Yes, it is 100. But as I have written this in a calls attribute, that means the browser or the frame will be stored or viewed in a vertical manner, three different section in a vertical manner. Here I am given the frame border equals to 10. It is optional, it is up to you, because the frame border will not that much importance. When we are using in JavaScript, there your border will be take a important role. But in case of HTML file, your frame border you will use just for a view. And 10 pixel is very much small pixel, so we can just view that. Next, inside the frame set, we are taking the frame name. Look, for as I have executed or I have used three different, I have to use three different file, so I have to take three different frame. We cannot write all the code of all the section in a single frame. So whatever section I am going to divide, I have to use three different frame. That number of frame tag has to be used under the frame set. Okay, so in the first frame, I have given it as name, and my src attribute hold the path of my file that will be present. Let me update it as top one, because I have given the file as top one, middle and bottom. And this is the whole path for my file. As which file? The HTML file that we have created just before, right? Look, here I am using another attribute called as scrolling. Remember, in case of frame tag, the attribute scrolling is there. And scrolling here, I have written yes. There are two different values, either yes or no. Yes means the scrolling has to be enabled, and no means the scrolling has to be disabled, right? So just like that same, here the second line using this SRC and scrolling. Here the third line using the SRC and scrolling, okay? So let me use or execute first this, then we will change some code in this file and we will view what has happening in the browser. So save as, let me give a name, HTML same, frm.html. HTML is the extension. Save. Look, here the file is executed, html.frm. When I will double click, this is my whole browser window, right? This is my first HTML file in the name of top one. This is my second HTML file, and this is my third HTML file, right? Top one, middle, and bottom. So look, as I have given in the calls attribute, 25, 50, and 25. So you can see that the whole browser window area will be divided, where this file will take 25%, this file will take 25%, and this file will take the 50% of the window area. Okay. And whatever program we have written inside top one, that is the background color is yellow, and I have written a message in the H1 tag as my top frame, that will be executed successfully. Simultaneously, we can able to execute another file with middle name having the background color aqua and the message as my middle frame, as well as in the third. So you can able. Remember, we have used the scrolling tag, right? So we have to demonstrate whether it will be work or not. Look, when I am taking the mouse pointer, automatically it will be changed into a two-dimensional arrow or two-sided arrow. So according to that, I can able to change my width location or able to change my percentage area that I have previously given. But if you are not using scrolling, or if you are making the value of the scrolling tag as no, then the percentage whatever you have given in the code, that will be fixed, that cannot be modified, right? So I guess there will be no doubt here, but let me change it to rows, ROWS, file, save as, same name, .html, yes, am I audible?
Yes, audible, ma'am.
I am very sorry, actually by mistake I have closed the browser, so I am logged out. Let me present my screen once again.
Okay, ma'am.
When you are changing the calls attribute with the rows attribute, now there are three different sections once again, but here now the work area or the browser area will be separated in a horizontal manner. The percentage will be same, 25, 50 and 25, but it will be shows in a horizontal. So one silly question you can arise here. Why only horizontal or only vertical? Can we mix up the two? Yes, we can mix up the two, but according to that, we have to specify the location of each and every frame. That also, I will demonstrate you. Let's suppose here in the code, we are using here, suppose rows. Let's suppose we are taking two rows, right? And we are dividing our section. First, we are dividing our section into two different horizontal section. Then, in first section, I will keep this top one HTML, but the next two will be in the second row. So we have to again define the same frame set but with columns attribute, columns p, just paste it, and here I am changing the attribute as false, right? Let's suppose I have changed it to 30 and 70 because the total should be always 100%. And here in the two column, I have to cap the two different middle file and the bottom file. Okay, so let's here, just for the sake, it is optional, but you can give a closing tag of the frame set. Okay, why we are giving the closing tag? Because if we are using a single frame set, then no need to use the closing tag. But if you are using the frame set in a hierarchical manner, then you have to use this closing tag of the frame set for the inner one, right? So let me once again save it. .html. Yes. As you can view, according to our coding, we have first of all divide the screen into two different horizontal area having the percentage 50-50. So this one is complete 50 because in the first frame set we have written only one frame tag, right? But inside the single second frame tag we have written two different by separating the attribute with columns. So it will be once again divided into a column type where this one is having the 30% and this one is having the 70% of area. But again, as we have used the scrolling, so we can change the section according to our convenience. Look, I have used the border as 10 value. So you can see a minute difference of gray color border in between all the three frames. Okay, 10 pixel is very much small one, so it will be a minute gray color border because I have not given the border color. We can also give the border color. So in this way, we can able to divide a different frame, or we can able to execute multiple frames, multiple HTML code in a single browser area. Okay, and that is the use of frame set tag and frame tag inside your HTML code. Okay, beside this, there is another frame or specialized frame tag is used called as iframe. Look, here whatever we have find in the browser, the total area is divided into different section only. Okay, but whatever content we have to put, we have to put in individual frame tag. Okay, but if someone want, no, my complete browser will be fixed with my program having paragraph, code, etc. And specifically, I want another HTML file to be appear in a specific location. That means either in the center or either in the corner in a box type or either in the left part. So in that case, you cannot say that the total frame can be possible to be divided through your percentage value. Here, we have to use another specialized frame called as inline frame. So what is an inline frame? Frames can also be used inside another HTML document page. Look, here I am emphasizing the document page. That means the original file contains some documents, some textual data. And inside the textual data, in some specific location, you are going to incorporate the second HTML file. So for that, you have to use the iframe, right? Here, why a specialized tag is used? Why not frame tag is used in that same idea? Because iframe is the inline frame tag allowed the frame to appear anywhere in the document. Here, no need to use the percentage value, whether you want 50%, 30% or 20%. You have to only specify the area. And how you can specify the area? By giving the width and height. Here I have written it supports all the attribute of the frame set tag, right? It is used the frame set tag, but still that it will use another two attributes which I have forgotten to written here, that will be your height and width. So whenever we are going to use the iframe, then the height value and then the width value, how much window you want for the new frame, right? Otherwise it will be same as your frame set. Next, whenever here up to now we have discussed about various tag that is related to the HTML document, but till now we are not associated those are available in nowadays online document. That means whenever we are going to form fill up an online document, a biodata or a registration form or an examination form, anything, there are various different tools are there, various different specification are there, which also be designed through your HTML tag, and those are called as form, as because it will hold the data, save the data, take the data from the user and save it in the backend. That's why it required another specialized tag that is called as your form. Okay, so now we are going to study how we can create our own form. The output will be in the browser, but the form we are displayed, that will be completely designed by ourselves using our HTML tag. Look, here I am called the advanced HTML. That means when HTML, till now we have executed a simple HTML file and we can only view the output. We cannot do anything inside the browser, right? But in case of advanced HTML, there are various features are incorporated where we can not only design our browser, not only put some data on the browser, but we can allow the user to give its output or to give its data, and we can save those data in our backend system. So whenever HTML will be associated with another scripting tag or with another database, then for the front end type, we need the form tag. Okay, before going to this, I just want to describe what is the meaning of backend and front end. Can anyone from the learner describe the backend and front end? A simple definition, what does it mean? Back and front. Okay, let me explain. Whenever we are using some application and that will be viewed to the user, that is called as your front end. Front end means the application that will be interface with the user directly, that is called as front end. Look, just take an example of an ATM machine. We are going to the ATM machine, we are inserting the card, okay, and then there will be some options are available. That will be, whatever options are available, that will be called as your front end for the user. From the content, we can able to know what we have to do. But whenever we are going to click some banking, let's suppose banking option I have chosen, then I have to give my password. Whenever I am giving my password and clicking the next or clicking automatically, then it will automatically save those data. So from the front end application, the data will be saved in some back end application. So those which are not directly interact with the user, those application are called as back end. We are used various backend application. We are used database to store the data. We are using JSP script, KB script, .NET. There are various backend application are there whose job is to accept the data from the front end application. So always the front end have that much suitability so that a single Maven user can able to understand what it has to do or what it has to perform. Whenever any action will be performed, then the specific event application will be associated with the backend. This type of programming is called as your event-driven programming. Just your VBScript or Visual Basic, those are the event-driven programming. Whenever the user will click on the button, then only it will save. Before clicking, it will not save. So whenever any specific event will occur over the front end, then only the back end will be enabled. Otherwise, it will be disabled. Okay. So we are not discussing more about the front end back end relationship, because when we are using our JavaScript program, there we can easily understandable what the linking between the front end and the back end. So till from this point, we are going to only concentrate about the front end screen, and that will be able to design through your form tag. Okay, So HTML forms are the front-end application which always collects some data from the user and then post it into some back-end application, right? As I have discussed briefly. So for that, for designing a form, we have another tag called as form tag. The name is form, that means you are going to create a form. Okay, creating form in an HTML form. So what are the attributes? For specifically form tag, there are basic three different attributes. One is action, second is method, and third is target. But remember, I am not describing briefly about these three tags because these tag values are associated with the backend. That means what the form will do when it will be associated with a backend application, then its action will be defined, the script at the backend, which type of script, right? Whether we are using JavaScript, whether we are using JSP, whether we are using VB.NET or any other script, so ASP, so that will be defined in your action attribute. Okay, here we have to give the, if I am using the JavaScript as backend, then I have to give the JavaScript name in the action attribute. Similarly, the method will define two different things. Either you have to receive some data from the form or save some data, or you have to take some data. So that will be defined in two different values. One is get and post. When we are using post, that means from the backend, something will be posted over the frontend, right? And when we are using get, that means the backend will get some value from where? From the frontend. Okay. Next is your target. Target will hold the place, the file name where you want to store the data. So these three will be always associated with the backend part. Next come to the designing of form. Inside the form tag, there is another tag called is your various control tag inside the form tag. That means we have to start from form tag and we have to end from slash form tag. But inside that, you have to use various control for various specific data type or various specific type of data that you want to enter. Okay, so these are called as controls of the form. There are various type of controls are there: text input control, checkbox control, radio box control, select box, submit, reset, or any other type of buttons. Okay, before going to the individual type of control or before going to demonstrate the individual type of control, you need to know why these are called as controls. Why not attributes? Because previously we are associated tag with attributes, but here we are using another name called as controls, right? So why it is called as control? Because in each and every type, the user will give some input and the browser has to control that input, right? If we have to enter the text, that means there should be a specific area where you can able to enter the text. Because when we are clicking in normal browser window for any HTML file, there is nothing happen. But to control the browser, when a user will entry or insert some data, there should be a specific input area has to be there. And that has to be controlled by that specific text input control. Hence, these are called as the controls. That means they have the ability to handle the form. Whatever designing we have given, how to handle that, all these tags or controls have their specific job. So text input means all the text type input will be controlled by this tag. Checkbox, radio box, we will discuss further one by one. Okay, so first of all, next come to your text input control. Look, inside the form tag, your text input will be written as input type. Here, type is the attribute. Okay, and that attribute type will define that the input tag have the text input control. That means it has to accept the characters alphabets at the text type data, like our username, address, these type of thing will be written inside this tag. Okay, so it allow a single line of text input. Look, remember, whenever we are inserting some text, we may be insert it in a single line, we may require more than one line. So for specific type of data, specific tags are available in HTML. Okay, and all are inside your input tag except text area. So what if I am given type as text? That means a single text has to be inserted, a single line of text has to be inserted, just like name, middle name, surname, etc. When I am using type equal to password, look, here the user will insert character. Whatever we are using as our password name, we have to type, and that will be accepted in a character format, whether it will be a special symbol, whether it will be a numeric, or whether it will be a character, that will be accepted as a string. But when the type will be password, it allow the single line of text, whatever text we have given in the box, that will be hide with some specific symbol. Mostly we are using the star symbol or the dot symbol for the password type, so that we are entering it, the user will entering the data in the character format, but it will be viewed or saved or hidden through some symbols or called as star, and all are familiar with the password type. Okay, in a net banking also, or in any type of application area, we have to give the username. Username is visible because its type is text, and your password name is invisible because its type will be password. Okay. Next, another type that is called as your text area. This is the single one that will allow your multi-line text input. Just example, we have given the address name, or we have to write some description. In that case, we have to use the text area. Okay. How it will be used in the demonstration part, we will design a form, because form designing with some attributes is a must question in your practical exam specifically. You have to be design your form with some specific controls. Okay, that is a sure cert must question. So here we are also going to demonstrate that. So text area, remember, multi-line text. Just example, address, description. Next, come to your text input attributes. Inside the above three control, there are several attributes once again, because with attributes, we can modify our data. We can customize our controls. So here, these are the different attributes for specifically input type text. So type, whether it is single line or password, that we have discussed in the previous slide. Name, the heading of the text. Look, whenever we are using, we have to write username, then the area where the name has to be entered. So how to write that username, that you have to be given in the name attribute. The value, if you want the text box or text area will be blank or with some initial value, that will be given in the value. Size will specify the width of the box, how much the box width will be, the text box width. Max length will define the maximum number of characters allowed, whether it will be 10 or whether it will be 15 or whether it will be 20, that will be according to you. There will be no specification of any limitation. You can give the max length. Mostly it is defined as a 50. Okay, rows, the total number of rows allowed in multi-line. Look, rows and columns, these two attributes are only worked in the text area, not in the input text type, right? Why? Because here we are only allowing multi-line. So in multi-line, we have to specify how many rows, total number of rows allowed, and how many total number of columns will be there in the text area. Okay, here look, I have taken an example that given in your SLM only. In the last, after discussing all the controls, we will design a complete form with all the controls, right? So Here, look, inside the body tag, a form tag is there, but I am not using any attribute like action, anything, right? I have used only the form tag, give a name, first name. Then inside this, I have give the input tag of type text. So here again, I have given using the attribute name as the first name. So this will be used in the form, right? But inside the form, whatever we are writing, that will be confined in some specific area. That means this is the beginning of the form and this is the ending of the form. And inside that, you have to use the input type tag. Okay. According to the type and according to the name. So first underscore name. It is a name given to the text box, right? Then I am using a break tag because I have to demonstrate these two text box in a row, vertical manner. Okay, so here I am using the break tag to initiate it with a new line. Break is used for new line, right? So again, in the new line, I have started with last name and again, I have designing a text box with the last underscore name. Remember, whatever name you are given for the text box, that will be treated as its ID and that will be used in the backend program. That means this text box will be named as first underscore name. This text box will be named as last underscore name. Okay, so whatever written here, that text will be associated with the form because this part doesn't have to relate with the backend. Only the data inside the text box that is related to the backend. So we have to give that in the input tag, right? So here I am using and this is the output as you can view. Simple, I am just using a text box or type of text box where the user can allow to insert the text. Okay, as my type is text, hence I can only insert a single line of text. Okay, next come to your checkbox control, because here I am not demonstrating the password. In the last part, in the end of the session, when we are going to design a form, there we will use the password tag. Checkbox. As all of you know, in every form, there will be a small box-like structure. Whenever we are clicking on that box, a write symbol will be appear. Okay, that is called as your checkbox. Why it is named a checkbox? Because the user has to click on that, has to check on that. Okay, so what is a check? Why we are using checkbox control? Checkbox is used where more than one option is required to be selected from a list of operation. Just for example, whether you know any language, written, read, or both. So one person may only have the capability of read the English language. Another person has the capability of both reading as well as writing. That means it has to need two options. Another person, when it have to use the all the feature, that means reading, writing, as well as understanding. So there it need three options. So you cannot concentrate or you cannot confine any option in a single list. Okay, just excuse me. So in that case, your checkbox option will allow to select multiple options. Checkbox, remember, always more than one option is required to be selected from a list of options. Okay, so how we will use that tag, checkbox tag, again inside the input tag, because always we need to give some input and we need to extract some input from the user always. So we need the input type, and here it will be checkbox used to create a single checkbox at a time. So if we want 5 different option as checkbox, then we have to write 5 different input type checkbox with their specific name. Okay, what are the attributes? Type, as it is defined as checkbox always, then name of the checkbox, and the value. This is another most important attribute, because the value will allow the checkbox to enable or disable. It will have a binary value, the values that is used if the checkbox is selected. So it will take two different binary value, 1 and 0. 1 is true, that means the checkbox is enabled, its data has to be saved. 0 means the checkbox is disabled, that means the user cannot able to click on that checkbox. Okay, so according to your requirement, you can enable all the checkbox or you can disable all the checkbox. Okay, so here from the SLM again I have taken the example. Form, input type checkbox, name math, value on, right? And I have written the math. So this part, whatever written outside the input tag, will be displayed as the checkbox header, right? So as it is name math inside the input tag, that means the checkbox reference number in the backend application will be called as math. And its value is on, that means the checkbox is on. Whenever the user will click on that, it will be select the option math. Whenever the user click on the physics, it will be select both math and physics, because previously it is clicked math, then it clicked physics. So it choose all the option from the checkbox. Okay, so in this way we have to use multiple option. Remember another thing, just same as your checkbox type, there is another control called as radio button. Everyone have most familiar with the radio button tag. Whenever we have option like male or female or others, you cannot select both male and female, or you cannot select both male, female and other. You have to choose any single one from all the list. So if we are using checkbox will allow us to use or to select multiple option, but in some case you have to restrict that, right? So for that we are using the radio button. So same input type, and here you have to write the radio. Okay, otherwise all are same. The main difference between a checkbox and a radio button or control button is called as, inside checkbox you can allow to select more than one item from the list, but in case of radio button, at a single time you can allow to select a single option. That is the single difference between the checkbox and radio button, right? Next called as your select box. Select box is very familiar with us, because in any application, whenever we will click on some part, a drop down list will be appear with specific option. Okay, and that control is called as your select box. Select box is also known as drop down list. The the most familiar name to all of us, it's called as your drop down list, where a list of items displayed in a drop down menu. What is a menu? Menu means always some collection of items. Whenever we are going to some restaurant, we are first asking about what's in the menu or where is the menu. From that options we have to select. Okay, so drop down menu, as its structure is just a window dropping down from the area, that's it's called as drop down. So from the list, by default a single option can be selected at a time. Remember, you cannot select more than one item from the drop down as well. Like the radio button, here also you have to select a single. So mostly in online form, the name of the university or the name of the colleges or specifically the state name or district name, that are either designed through radio button or through the drop down list from where we have to select our state or district, right? So how to use that? Here there will be no input tag. Remember, this is a specialized one. Your checkbox, radio button, text box, all are comes under your input tag, whereas your select box or drop down list will be inside a tag called as select. Select name equals to drop down, used to create a single list. It has another sub tag to define the option inside the list. Look, when you are using checkbox and radio button, you have to write the specification of each and every button individually. If I am using 5 different list of options, I have to use 5 different checkbox. But what to do when we have thousands of options and we have to select from that? In that case, you cannot individually write individual checkbox or individual radio button. So in that case, your select will be used very specifically using another sub tag called as option. So select will be used to design the drop down, and what are the menu item present in the drop down list, that will be defined through your option tag. Okay, so both the tag, select tag and option sub tag, has different attributes. Okay, what is the need of different attributes? Why cannot they be same? Because select will define the size of the drop down window, the whether you are allowing to the user for multiple selection or not, and what are the value. These are the appearance of the window, right? The attributes that will define the appearance. But what are the option value, whether it will be selected or not, that will be confined through your option tag. So option tag is again value that is selected or on and off binary true and false type of. Then selected, where look, somewhere in our form there will be a drop down list, but there will be always an initial value will be shown. In some drop down lists it is blank and there will be a corner drop down arrow, but in some cases already a default option is there, so that can be defined through your selected and label tag. Okay, so these two attributes we will see how it will be used in our programs. Look, here I am taking the example for select name drop down option value math that is selected. I am using the attribute selected. Selected doesn't require any meaning, but if selected is written, that means it is considered as true. If selected is not written, that means it is considered as false by default. So this is one math, and inside the drop down math drop down list there are some values are there: math, DCA, then physics, then DCS, right? So here again I have using the selected tag or selected attribute in DCS. So as you can view in the drop down list, by default DCS is in a selected form. Okay, so if I want to use this DCS, I have to only click on that. But if I want to change some another option, then I have to click on the drop down arrow, and from the menu I have to select any one. So this is your select box. Then finally, the most important controls for a online form or for a form designing, that is three different control. One is submit, one is reset, another is button. All these three are looks like the button. So what is a button control? Button control is always performing an event and action. Action driven control. That means whenever we are clicking on the button, in the back end, it has to execute some code. So in our HTML form, what it will do, whenever we are clicking on the submit button, then the data that the user will written or fill off, that has to be saved. So for that, you have to given a button type that is again in the input tag, type submit. Whenever you are using this submit, it creates a button automatically that will submit the form data. Whatever data in the previous controls we have written, that will be automatically submit or saved in the backend type. Next, reset. Suppose there will be some mistake during the form fill up and we need to again perform the same process. So we have no need to delete individually. Simply click on the reset button. Okay, so what the reset type will perform? It creates a button that automatically reset with the initial value. Look, these two are the default button or the built-in button. That means whenever we are writing this or this tag, that means there will be a button structure and the submit is written over it. You cannot change the name. Similarly, in case of reset, you cannot change the name or the content of the button written over there is reset. But if you want to write OK or cancel, just we are using our Office application. We are using Word, Excel, PowerPoint, saving a file. In that case, there are two buttons. One is OK, another is cancel, right? For saving window, the button is name changed as save and cancel. So if you want to change the name of the button, change the appearance of the button with some different name, then you have to use the input type button type. It creates a button that trigger a client side action on a clicking event. The name will be according to the designing part, the designer choice. But whenever you are clicking on that button, some action has to be performed. Okay, and what action has to be performed? That is decided at the backend application program. In submit, the action will be to store the data. That is for sure, and that cannot be changed. In reset, the action is to again allow the user with a new value. The previous value will be deleted, right? But in case of button, you can given your own action, what you need to perform in your backend with the data, that you can given with the button type. Okay. So just look here, the input type submit, name submit, value submit. So here the submit button will appear like this. Similarly, reset button by default here, even if you have to give the value, it will always take as reset. Okay. But in case of button, you can change the value according to your event. What action you are going to perform, according to that, you can change the value type. So these are the three examples of your submit button, reset button, and OK button. One thing you need to remember, where we need to use the button control, whenever we want to perform some action-driven programming, that means the data has to be processed in the backend. In that case, to save the data, we need this button control. Okay. Otherwise, we can use checkbox, radio button, then drop-down list for only accepting the data from the user. But till now, we are not saving the data. For saving the data, you have to trigger an action, and that action will be mostly triggered using the button control. That is the job of the button control, right? So with this, we are discussed about our various type of controls used in the form. Let me demonstrate you how it will be designed. this is a little bit long HTML code. So we will start from the beginning. Head is there, title is there, body. Here I am giving a heading line, just example of form design controls. That's it. Okay. So in the form tag, there will be page center. Okay. That means this line has to be displayed in the center of the browser window. So when we are starting with the form, here we are using a first name. And in the first name, we are using the input tag. That means we are creating a text box here for the first name. Similarly, we are here creating the text box for the last name. We are using two different input tags with the type text, right? That means single line character insert. Next, for gender. As I have told you, I have to use the radio button or the control button. So here I have written the type as radio and what is the name and value. The name will be always gender because radio will always select a single option. So it has to be referenced with a single name. So that name is gender name and value is male. For first radio button, I have given male and it is in checked attribute. That means it is by default in a checked mode. Right? Here it's name. Then similarly, I have used another two radio button with the same name gender, but the value will be female and other. That means whatever we have selected from male, female and other, a single option will be saved in the backend data in the form of or in the name of gender. Right? Similarly, here for hobbies, I have used the checkbox and there are 5 different checkbox. One is read, act, play, swim and color, right? So these are the checkbox where the user are allowed to select more than one option because one person can have more than one hobbies, right? Then here we are giving another type that I have not discussed before, that is the type color. Okay, and by default, it will show you the color box, whatever we have displayed in our font window or in our any color theme based window that will be displayed. I will demonstrate you. Then next is your option value. Here you have to select the option control for the text box that will be the drop down list, right? So what are the options present in the drop down list? Because here I am using the select tag and I have, as we have discussed, the select control is used for the drop down list. So the drop down list name is district, but what are its option? It has three different option. One is the Angul district, one is the Cuttack district, one is Kalahandi district. Another is Bari. So 4 different options are there. So these are the requirement for a drop down list. Similarly, for any other type of, that means if you want to use the Google search window in your option, that means someone will click on the Google, someone will click on the option, and when it will be click on the option, your Google search window will appear. So in that case, you can design that through your search type, okay? But it may not execute in our program because for referencing to the Google search is another browsing window, another HTTP control window, and you need to write the binding of two different browser window. You need to write the program in the backend side. Either it will be in a JavaScript format, so linking. So that part may not be executed in our program as we are only using the front end type, right? Then birthday, for date type also, we can give in the birth type date. For time, we can also give the time. I will discuss some of this. Here there will be a password. For password, we are using the type password and name password. similarly for telephone. But these name, date, type, URL, these are only used for HTML5 version. In the older version, you may not allow. In older operating system, these controls may not work. But these are mostly introduced in your HTML5.0 version. So these are the various different tags. And in the last part, here, look, we are also using a text area for the description part. And here in the text area, as I have told, there will be some value for rows and there will be some values for column. That means you have to design a window in which area or in how much area you want to write the description. Okay. And in the final one, you have to use the submit, reset and button tab. Okay. So let me save this. myphone.html. Click on save. Here, this is my form. I hope it will work. Yes. Look. In the starting part, I have written something inside the center tag. So this will be viewed in the center part. Then this is the text box area where we can insert any text. We have used three different tags, so we can insert any text. Then look, this is the radio button. I can only select a single one. So whenever I am using to click on a single radio button, automatically the previous one will be disabled, right? So according to this feature, we have to write the backend program. So if one is true, then all others should be in false value. Okay, but that is changed in your text box type. I can select multiple checkbox. So among all the type, there will be more than one true value for different option. There may be all true value for different option. Here, look, I have using another type equals to caller. Okay, so when we will click on that, this caller window will automatically attribute. You no need to write anything for selecting a caller. Okay. Next is your drop down list. This is your drop down list, and by default, Angle is selected mode and all other are in the option value. Similarly, your Google search. I don't think it will work here because whenever we are type something, let's suppose HTML, let me write. No, it's not working because we are not linking the Google browser with our form. So it will here not work, but when we are linking the file, it will sure show you the home page of the Google search. Similarly, for birthday, by default, this type of window will appear. Okay, and this is only possible in HTML5. You can insert, select the date, you can select the month, you can select the year. Similarly, for time, you have to insert the time, and by default, it will be changed as AM or PM. So it is a built-in design for your input type time. Next, user ID, simple text box, but password. When we are writing something in the password, automatically it will be in a hidden manner. So the text will be hidden. Telephone, website, you can give anything. Birthday, once again, it will be viewed as the calendar font or calendar window by default. Email address, you can give email address. Here, the value is already displayed because you have to instruct the user how to write the email address. There will be name of the email, there will be an address symbol, and there will be a domain name with domain type. So this is an example where you instruct the user how to write the email address. And look, this is the text area. We have given rows value 5 and column value 50, right? So I guess this height will be of 5 rows, inserting 5 rows, and this width will be of 50 columns. So it's there will be a window area specifically for text area tag. And at the last, here is the submit button, the reset button, and the OK button. When we are clicking, finally, after clicking or filling of the form, when we are clicking on the submit button, then whatever mandatory field that is left by the user, that will be highlighted or that has to be written in the program. Okay. When we are clicking on the reset type, all the inserted will be disappeared, deleted, and they will be in the previous form, the initial form. The form will be in the initial type. And okay, we can click for any other event to temporarily save or to move to another window. For that also we are using. You can view that in most of the online form fill up, there are 4 different steps are there. In step 1, you have to fill up your bio data. In step 2, you have to fill up your academic details, your qualification details. In step 3, you have to give the research details of your papers, etc. Then in the 4th part, you have to pay the fee. So in that case, your OK type button will used for linking from one page to another page. So in this way, we can able to design. And remember, this one is the most important question, not only in your practical exam, maybe in your theory exam, as well as in your future appearance where you need to design some HTML code for any online form fill up. Okay. So I guess with this, we have completed all the advanced feature of HTML specifically. And in the next class, we will be moved to the CSS, the cascading style sheet. How more lively we can design our code, we can design our appearance in the browser, that will be through your CSS style. CSS is not a markup language. It is a type of advanced feature in HTML that is specifically named as your CSS. Okay. So before winding up this session, I just want to view you something from your SLM. In the last part, there will be some HTML5 input type. So here you can view what are the input types that are incorporated in HTML 5.0 only. These are the new input type where by default you can allow to give time, you can allow to give date, you can allow to give color, month, number, range, etc., etc. Okay. And in the SLM, all this tag, how it has to be written, that are briefly discussed, that we have demonstrated here, the date, the time, month, any type of other value. You can easily refer your SLM for any type of doubt. Okay. So with this, I am thanking you all for this session. And if the learners have any query, they can ask or they can write in the chat box.
Thank you.
Yes, sir.
Thank you, madam. Both briefly describe kalle. Really, mu bahut khushiyali mu jetre HTML padhutli. To amane hoye to ete description kori ki sir mane padhau nathile. To kichhi question learner mane deichanti 6-7 more questions. To mu seta tike apanko pakre present karuchi. Ebang apan seta ko simply tike describe kardebe.
Okay, sir.
Okay. First question is, what about static and dynamic web pages?
Right. So whenever we are discussing about the type of web page, in that case, you have to define whether it is a static web page or whether it is a dynamic web page. Okay. As the term, static web page is a single standalone web page whatever you are performing on a single web page, that will be called as static web page, right? And whenever you are linking with some, that means inside a website, you have to link different web pages, and so that you can able to view from one page to another page, you can able to move from one to two as well as two to one. In that case, you have to be play the role of the dynamic web page, right? But here we are only concentrating about the feature, the tag of the HTML. So in that case, you cannot define whether it will be a static, because we are by default using the static web page or static browser, right? When we are written some programming in the backend to link the pages to create a complete website, then the term dynamic web page will be used. Okay, so simply you can able to understand what is dynamic means, moving, able to move from one page to another page, or able to link from one page to another page, then it will be called as your dynamic web page. And mostly we have used the A tag, AHREF tag, for linking the dynamic web page, right?
Okay, thank you madam. Next question, data question ko mix karke mu kahi douchi, same type ra achi question. The backend is server side stuff.
Look.
And backend is behind the screen scripts database.
When we are communicating the front-end data with some server-side programming, then the back-end is a server, right? But when we are storing the front-end data in our own system or in any other network through some script, then that script is also called as back-end. So mostly back-end means it will be dependent on some script language where the data has to be processed, okay? But if the script is loaded in a server system, then that is called as your backend server. So in backend server, there may be a database file, there may be a multiple script file where the data are used in different form. So that is up to the requirement, what the application need, what the application will do with the data. That will be your backend system. I guess, I can able to clear your doubt.
Okay, thank you ma'am. Next, front end is for user interaction.
Yes.
Front end is,
yes,
for
absolutely.
Okay,
so that is the question, sir. Is front end is user interaction?
Okay
yes, always front end means who will be at the front part? What application is viewed by to the user so that it can able to perform something or perform some action? That is called as front end. So always front end need to be interface with the user. Mostly it is designed so that can be easily available, understandable by the user. Just example of front end, you can give the ATM, you can give any type of just like in bank, we are using some machine to print the checkbook, right? Nowadays in every branch, there will be a printing machine which will specifically used for printing the checkbooks. So that is also provide a front end to the user, which instruct us what to do or what to do by the user. So those are always related to user. Front end means always interact with the user.
Okay, thank you. Very nice describe. The next, madam, backend is database stuff in server side, front end, and about user interaction place.
Yes, as I have told you already, front end means user interaction, right? And accept the, for system point of view, what is the job of front end? It will accept the data from the user, right? That is the main role of the front end. Then in the back end, what need to be used, what need to be performed over the data, that will be depend by the back end application. So backend application are mostly used for server side, where you have to control everything, right? But you always cannot say that backend is only server, because there are various scripting languages that may not be inside the server, but they can able to store the data in the database file in any simple system. So that is also called as your backend. When you need to control the data, to use the data in that type, mostly we are preferable to be a server system. Why? Because server system has the authenticity as well as the accessibility power to control everything. So it is better to keep save those data in a server system like the backend. But you need to be linking whatever you are using, a scripting or you are using a server system, you need to be link that with a front end through a scripting language only. Okay,
thank you ma'am. So etiki question amar thila ebong kichhi learner lekhichanti. Very well organized, explained, presented, time management, managed session by Sagarika madam. Thank you madam.
Thank you, Prabhat sir.
Hello. बहुत बढ़िया लेक्चर थी. हेलो. तो मैडम मु आ गोटे रिक्वेस्ट करबि आपन को. तो लर्नर मानन को खरे मु भाबु छी जे तो आपन भी एकेडमी कंसल्टेंट अछंती मु भी अछि हम पाकर जे अछंती ताको सतर हम टिके डायरेक्टली मु भाबु छी टिके कथा हबा जदी आपन परमिशन मते देबे बिकॉज यू आर अ रिसर्च पर्संस मु को स्टडी सेंटर रु को लर्नर अछंती भाबु छी टिके कथा हबा ताको सतर एटा हम पाई गोटे
अपॉर्चुनिटी. Yes, sir.
Yeah, Sandhika ma'am.
Yes, sir.
Apna kisi difficulty achi ki jo PPT apna present kare today, seta right away apna ko mail ba anywhere pathe karibe, so that because apna just present kare we have gone through, so apna je PPT amu samne asle na, ami immediately easily recapitulate karibu. Delay hai gele, then we keep on forgetting, losing.
Okay. Yes,
very important that you send it today itself. And most of my colleagues man kara, learners man kara. Equal same request. So apna mane probably apna system hoti bodhe pathanti some editing etc. kare pe. We don't feel that any necessity of that kind of editing and delays. Apna aji kindly pathe the better hoga for us.
ठीक अच्छे. पंडा सर हमें try करो चाहिए. हाँ.
Sir, let me say something. Actually, we need the editing part for the video of this session, right? But if you want only the PPT part, then please let me ping in my own mail, my personal mail, that is msagarika@gmail.com, right? This is my personal mail ID. You can ping me, just give a message in my mail so that I can send it directly to you. Whoever be the learner who want this specific PPT of this class and as well as the previous class, just give me a mail. I will directly send them the mail. Okay, so that will be the most direct way of sending, and you can easily get it directly, instantly. And otherwise, after editing, we can post these PPTs in our website or in eGyanajyoti. Right.
Okay. Good, madam. Thank you.
So we are winding this session, sir.
Okay, madam. Thank you,
everyone.
Today, our session is over. Many thanks, our resource person, Sagarika madam. Briefly description kalle, bahut sundar bhabare. Mu bi bahut khushi heli. Mote lagila mu class 7-8 re palla bade sir mane jemti padhauthile. मैडम सेमिति ब्रीफली बुझेले जोटा कि आम मैंने समस्ते बुझिपाले एवं सेथिपाई लर्नर माने भी बहुत सुंदर मेसेज देइचंती मैडम को एप्रिसिएशन तो सेथिपाई बहुत खुशी एवं डियर लर्नर आपण मानकर कोऑपरेशन एमिति आम साथिरे थाउ एवं चेष्टा करिवु निश्चित भावरे डे टू डे केमिति सुंदर टेक्नोलॉजी द्वारा आपण मानक पाखरे आमे पहुंची परिवु डायरेक्टली. थैंक यू. जदि लर्नर मैंने मत टाइम देवे 2 मिनिट्स मुझे चाहूँगी लर्नर मान साथ 2 मिनिट्स टी इंटरेक्शन होगा मुझे जानवाक चाहूँगी. एक्चुअली मुझे जड़े जड़े लर्नर को ना कह तो एक्चुअली से स्टडी सेन्टर अच्छा प्रवीण कुमार सराफ। तो सर आपण कौन स्टडी सेंटर रे अछंती? वॉइस आसुनी, म्यूट अछि, अनम्यूट करंतु। प्रकाश चंद्र बारिक,
सर एफएम कॉलेज, एफएम यूनिवर्सिटी।
ओके गुड, वेरी गुड। एफएम ऑटोनॉमस कॉलेज स्टडी सेंटर प्रकाश।
अगेन सर एमएससीएस स्टूडेंट।
ओके गुड गुड गुड। ओके
समू प्रवीण, एमएससीएस थर्ड सेमेस्टर।
प्रवीण बाबू कौन स्टडी सेंटर?
एमएससीएस थर्ड सेमेस्टर आपण
को। हां हां प्रवीण बाबू कौन स्टडी सेंटर रे?
स्टडी सेंटर नहीं, आपण एमएससीएस करू छी।
नहीं आपण कौन स्टडी सेंटर? कौन संबलपुर स्टडी सेंटर?
हां हां संबलपुर स्टडी सेंटर।
ओके थैंक यू। मिस्टर प्रभात कोंडा सर आपण कौन स्टडी सेंटर रे अछंती? म्यूट अछि प्रभात सर आपनकर म्यूट अछि।
हां हां आरसीएम भुवनेश्वर।
वेरी गुड वेरी गुड। थैंक यू, टुडे आवर सेशन इज क्लोज हियर। थैंक यू ऑल ऑफ यू।
थैंक यू भवेश सर, थैंक यू ऑल लर्नर्स।
ओके थैंक यू।